And I follow of the Hanafi madhab, adopt the Shafi opinion with regards to combining the prayers. And they also do the same with regards to praying in a sitting position when in a form of transport. Please comment specifically if there is difference between cars, coaches, trains, or planes. Jazakallahu khairan.
وأفضل الصلاة والتسليم على سيدنا محمد الصادق المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا، وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما وفقنا إذا علمتنا. فوجود المنذ بالتقدير والإيمان يشد ميت the regulation of his madhab. Otherwise, this is called the tawfiq. Here is not necessary to follow Shafi'i. You have also the Maliki and Hanbali. And at least whenever you want to combine Muslim prayer, it should fit according either to Shafi'i, Maliki or Hanbali, not necessary to be in Shafi'i. What was the basis of the question?
Can they also do the same with regard to praying in a sitting position?
Based on my knowledge, I don't know about any difference between Shafi'i and Hanafi in this regard. And without a significant excuse, you cannot pray sitting on chair, if the meaning of it is sitting on chair. This we call it, don't call it in Arabic Salat al-Qa'id, sitting. The Salat al-Qa'id, the one who doesn't stand but makes sujood on the ground. Whereas the one who is on chair, this is called mumi. Mumi, that means he doesn't perform sujood. And this is not sitting. We don't call it sitting. This is mumi. And to best of my knowledge, the excuse is the same. Out of necessity, you may do it. Otherwise, this is invalid. The difference, if we have a person pray mumi, you have the right, even if you stand, you know, to pray behind him and call him as imam, whereas the Hanafi is not willing.
Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu said after the death of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that whoever worship Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let him know Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is dead. Whoever worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let him know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is alive and will never die. I have praised this saying. How should we understand this saying?
This should be understood according to the verse with it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed the Prophet to say, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. The Prophet never called for himself, he called for Allah. And the most blessed among us, those who learned from the Prophet how to contact Allah, how to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how to build their relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Shaykh Akbar said that at the death of the Prophet, none of the companions had this ability except Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And this is, was looked at as a specialty of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. The rest, all of them, they haven't yet reached that point, that rank of being connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Is the Bismillah at the beginning of each surah except Surah Tawbah part of the revelation, i.e. was it revealed at the beginning of each surah?
I think this is the strongest opinion, you know, because in one narration, the Prophet ﷺ did not know the end of the surah and the beginning of another surah till he had Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, which should be revealed. If the question about it's not considered from the beginning of that surah, no, according to majority of scholars, it's not considered as part of the beginning of that surah, except Imam Shafi'i. Imam Shafi'i considered Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim in the first verse as the first verse of each surah.
A chukra of a single woman married to non-Sayyid Ahlul Bayt according to Shafi'i.
No, if you speak about the rules in this life, no. According to all madhab, they are not, يعني they don't fit the rules of this dunya. If you speak about being close to the Prophet and have some special intercession or special work, let's hope, يعني we should hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This may be the case. And this, I know about a famous scholar called Sheikh Jamal Din Qasmi in Syria. He wrote a book about saying from the mother's side, like for the rules in this dunya, no, for the rules in the hereafter, and intercession and being respected and beloved, yes.
If we have relatives who are non-Muslim, are we sinful if we don't try or succeed to bring them to Islam?
For success, nobody blame. Okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala definitely doesn't blame anyone for not being non-successful when he work hard or try, okay. To try, I think we should try. Being sinful, I cannot be sure about it unless you are in a position, you are the one who is obliged to convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to that particular person, then you may be considered as sinful. Otherwise, I cannot look at the case as a sinful action.
I have a child of an adult age. She is a single female. I would like to go to study abroad by myself. What is my responsibility in terms of her care while I'm away? Is it permissible for me to leave her?
Yes, they should have mahram. I have noted they did not highlight the point of mahram. Anyway, if you wanted to have the answer limited to your child or to your girl, again here it's a very common question, you know, and you have different answers to this question according to the personality and the practice and behavior of that particular game. For the mother, weigh the advantages and the disadvantages and go with it. Personally, I would like you to stay with your daughter, because generally speaking, people they tend to travel, you know, and go saying that we seek the Islamic knowledge, you know, which may be a bit of a different setting, you know, but to stay with your daughter is much more important, you know, to guard her and to win the relation. And nowadays, you see, in your communities and in our community, you know, I see the family relation get weakened more and more. And this is one of the reasons of it, you know, when you keep being separated, you know, from your daughter, she is not going to love you a lot, and you are not going to love her a lot, okay? The relation is going, and this is the nature of humankind. Whenever he is away for a while, he's going to tend to be forgotten or ignored or this or that. So I highlight the importance, you know, of building the relation.
Is there a special dua that a mother can read for their children who are studying sacred knowledge, hifz, tajweed? Something we can read on a daily basis.
ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. Is in the Quran.
السلام عليكم شيخ. I really enjoyed your history classes and I hope you do something similar at a later date. An important lesson for me was the effect of disunity of Muslims on both micro and macro scales. How do we go about achieving unity in the UK and also balancing this with the struggle for unity as an ummah?
I think, as I answered the previous questions, we should firstly try to make our families strong. Our families, they are too weak, okay? Strengthen our family, build our relation very well, have sincere relation with your friends, you know. Many friends, you know, their relation is going to be according to their benefit or advantages or money-wise or whatever. Let's have it according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then, for sure, in your community, you should try to improve yourself. You know, one day, I was in Birmingham and I asked the one who hosted me, you know, to go and pray in the central mosque, you know, which is was a strange movement, you know, for everyone, you know. And this is, let's try to make it, you know, more, you know, try to practice to go and pray in the other's mosque, you know, and by this, inshallah, we'll build much more relation.
If you are reading the Quran on the phone, do you need to have a room? If no, does this mean sisters who may be menstruating can continue to read via the phone?
Here we have the touch matter and the recitation matter. Touch matter, you may touch the phone. Why? Because to best of my knowledge, you have a glass or some other material, you know, as a barrier. You don't touch the real wording, you know, of the Quran. This for touching. For recitation, recitation is prohibited in janabah state and menstruation state. Yani, in another word, the menstruating woman, if she is afraid of forgetting her memory of the Quran, she may open the this telephone and try to memorize by looking, not by recitation.
If someone's actions are angry with you and something a person has said about you has offended you, what is the best thing to do to resolve the matter, and what is the best thing to do to eliminate the anger?
For the first point, to forgive him, you know, or تصدق بعرضك, that means to pay as a charity to that person, you know, and forgive him. How to take away the anger, we should say أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, perform wudu, try to settle down, and inshallah will take away it.
Should we be demanding more from the scholars in the UK?
Yes, I think so, because yani, I name them, you know, I know 5, 6, or 7 of them, you know, who studied in Syria, and everyone is by his own. In my imagination, I don't know how accurate I am, they should work with them together, have some cooperation, and by this they are going to help the community much more. So please, the community, the Jewish people, you know, keep nagging them on that.
Assalamu alaikum, Sidi. Please could you give a general explanation, description of Ruhaniya, Tariqah, and Lataf?
The definition of these three words?
It's a generous explanation, description.
Ruhaniya, that's mean those feeling which is not physical or not seen. Okay, this was the meaning by Ruhaniya. Then it has been used for the good one, because here you have the good and the bad one. Bad one, most of them, they are from the jinn side. Good one could be from the jinn, even though I don't, yani, care about them a lot, or which is most important, to be from the angels or from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what we mean by ruhani, the spiritual state which not related to physical or good explanation in the seen way. About tariqah, we have all terminology of it and new terminology. The old terminology of tariqah, it's the way between sharia and haqiqah. We have sharia and haqiqah. Those who attended what we have said, with say the Ansar, they know the meaning of sharia and haqiqah. Or if you don't want or did not attend sharia, as Sheikh Al-Islam put it, as if what has been defined as Islam in the hadith of Sayyidina Jibreel. And haqiqa, what was defined as iman in hadith Sayyidina Jibreel. Tariqa is the way, your way of practice your Islam till you reach your illuminated and ruhani heart. This is the tariqa according to the early scholars. You know, later on, the tariqa means that those famous turuq that lead you to Allah, namely Qadiri, Shadiri, Naqshbandi, and others.
In our communities, they have a habit of showing the face of a deceased person after ghusl and janazah. Is this okay, and is it permitted to take pictures or produce a video of the dead?
This is personal answer. I don't know about any hukm innovation that the fuqaha. But this is personal answer. I don't like this to be done to me. Okay. By this, I hate to have it done for the others. We have this famous sheikh in Syria. I attended, you know, the ghusl, yani, I did not like him. They may make it listen to him, and there's 30 persons, you know, surrounding him. You know, for me, yeah, it doesn't sound good, you know, to have video, to have this or that, you know, it doesn't sound that good, you know. I think, I'm not quite sure, I think those are habits of the non-Muslim, you know. We got them from the non-Muslim, okay? And because, to best of my knowledge, it was not practiced in the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And I'm against it, you know, this is personal feeling.
After the
Janazah.
To
everyone?
The men, yes, the women.
Yeah, we have it in Syria, but exceptionally for a few person, not for to everyone. Okay? Yani, this way, I have no problem with it. You know. But to be sure to everyone, you know, you have this person who never saw this person, you know, in his life. What's the point of seeing him now? Doesn't make any sense, you know? And you have a lot of crowds. The son of the cousin of your uncle, you know, passed away, come with me. And he never seen him, you know. Why to see him now? I don't, this is again, this is my personal feeling. I'm not telling you it's halal or haram, okay? I'm speaking about my personal feeling. I don't want to be practicing on me. And I don't remember that in the traditional, prophetic tradition, that we have something similar to it. I attended some of the janazas, they will call one or two, you know. Let's, yani, if we are waiting for such setting, you know, they will call two person, come please and see those who used to be close friend to him, you know. But for yani, I attended the janaza of famous sheikh, you know. They called my father, you know, and another person followed him. They only called my father. I did not go, even though I love that sheikh, you know, and I met with him frequently, you know. But I did not go because, yani, this is not the point, you know, of just go and see and look, you know. This is a matter of friendship, you know, or whatever. It's not a matter of show, to be shown to everyone. This is the way I look at it. I'm sorry, again, this is my input.
Can your praying sister read the basmala third hour the intention of a dua to practice the tajweed?
Before answering this question, I would like to highlight that the scholars, they are of two groups. One prohibited everything completely, and the other group of the scholars, they said if it's by the pattern of dua or zikr, it's okay. Why should I say so? Because nowadays, I feel we are not practicing this point, you know. They may read Surah Yasin, you know, as zikr, because every morning they read. I don't think this meant by them. And when you say Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana, when you say Rabbana la tuzigh quluba, when you say a'udhu billahi hasbunallahu wa ni'mal wakeel, okay, those matters they may be looked at. The whole Fatiha, I don't have definite answer now. But I personally don't like to overrule those rules which was being set up, you know, by the Holy Quran and the tradition of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam.
There is a popular series on YouTube about Sayyidina Umar, but they show the faces of the caliphs. Is it permitted to
face all
the Khalifa Rashid? Is it permitted to watch such program, and what is the rule with regards to actors playing prophets or Sahaba or Sahabiyat?
To observe this, you know, if you have benefit of it, no problem, no, of observing it. But don't put on your mind that this is the shape or the face of Sayyidina Umar or Sayyidina Abu Bakr. Since we have not been asked by those producers, you know, if it's permitted or not, I don't feel myself free to answer this question. That's it. The prophetic one, yeah, it's going to be more of prohibited, you know, what to be done.
What would you advise on having good company? How should one choose their friends? What qualities to look for?
The opposite of what mentioned in the hadith. The hadith said about shuh muta'a, dunya mu'sara, hawa muttaba'a, wa ajab kulli. When you have a person who is generous, he doesn't love, he hates dunya, where he doesn't be proud of his opinion and his principle, and he doesn't follow his passion, rather he come against himself. This is the best friend, you know, to join in this life.
Questions relating to young children. Assalamualaikum. I'm allowing all my house to pick baby up and pray.
This is if this baby has the ability to walk alone and be dependent, yes, you are allowed. Otherwise, not.
Walking or crawling?
Yeah, he is independent, you know. Whereas the one who is complete, no movement at all, you know, then he, she is considered or he is considered as carrying him.
Whilst praying salah to take something, this is again to ask children. Whilst praying salah to take something that will be harmful, risk of choking of a baby or toddler, will this invalidate your salah?
No. If it, no, if it was with movements less than three movements, but you are obliged to interrupt your prayer, even if it needed 100 movements, you know, of your hand, you shouldn't interrupt your prayer. You are obliged to interrupt your prayer, but if you have three consecutive movements, you know, this is going to invalidate your prayer. You are obliged to interrupt and you are obliged to repeat.
What is Sheikh of Tariqah supposed to help students achieve, or is it just show?
To achieve hatta uhibbah. Okay, which means فإذا أحببته كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به وبصره الذي يبصر. But here, it's not the problem of the Sheikh only, it's the problem of the student also. That's why I heard from some famous Sheikh, he said, Sayyid al-Qadir has only 1.5 student, not more than this, 1.5. And the Sheikh Akbar has only half. That's what I heard from famous Sheikh. Here, I don't think the problem is Sayyid al-Qadir or the problem is Sheikh Akbar. This is the problem of the student and his eligibility of it. Okay? So here, I don't blame the Shuyukh for this. You know, I would rather blame myself if I'm the student.
I believe all Muslims should know how to defend themselves. Is it permissible for a man to attend mixed gender classes to learn self-defense if he tries to avoid women present? Can a man also teach women to defend themselves if he has acquired this difficult skill? How can we protect ourselves and our other sisters from harm they may encounter?
It's prohibited. We have a lot of policies.
How do we remove the love of the dunya from our hearts and hearts of the ummah as a whole?
The Prophet highlighted strongly the remembrance of this. Whenever you remember the this all the time, remember the massive disease, if some of your family had very severe disease or whatever, this is going to be helpful. The one who worked as physician, this may not be helpful, you know, to go to graveyard will be perhaps much more helpful. The one who worked in the graveyard, perhaps the graveyard's not, and here you should have something extraordinary, something that you don't deal with every day, and for that, most of us, you know, remembrance of this itself, you know, and the detail of it, if you learn the detail, pick up these verses speaking about this, pick up those hadiths speak about this, and if they like al-Tazkira of Imam al-Qurtubi and other books, you know, speak about the diseased person, you know, and by this, this perhaps the best way of get the hate of this dunya.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh. You seem to be in very good health and I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala maintain you as such. Could you please offer some practical advice we can implement regarding our diets and also exercise? Many people travel the path of knowledge sincerely but get so focused on ilm that they do not stay in good health. This causes lethargy and eventually people stagnate and lose himma. What is the way to balance this as we try to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Out of my experience, you know, when you have like this, such this nice air, the fresh air, you know, for me, make me too energetic. I don't sleep the way I sleep, you know, back in my country here, you know, this fresh air area. And perhaps we should ask Sayyid Talha to arrange those fresh air areas, you know, all the time for us. Besides that, the best dieting to make fasting. The Prophet said, so tasihu, if you want to be healthy, you should have plenty of fasting. Besides, it also has been highlighted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like honey, like hamrat al-sawda, like many other things, you know, and to calm down in eating, generally.
How can we improve our tadabbur on the Quran?
Reflection. I'm going to speak about the experience of one of our friends who passed away, rahimahullah ta'ala. And he started reciting without having anything. After a while, you know, he told me that he experienced some taste, some sweetness there, whatever. When you try to expose yourself frequently to the Holy Quran, you are going to find some of this. I have no doubt about it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most generous and is going to grant us with these matters, you know, when we keep knocking the door, you know, just knock the door, sit down, recite Quran, even without the door, keep knocking the door, and one day you are going to start experiencing the sweetness of the Quran.
As a medical doctor, how would you advise to balance between modern medicine and Sunnah natural medicine?
I'm sorry to tell you, I'm not that experienced in this. This is a significant deficiency in myself, you know. I'm not that good, you know, in studying the prophetic medicine, even though I have the full belief in it, you know. But I'm sorry, I do not work in that field the way I should work.
Are there regular habits?
And by the way, the one who is interested in this, you know, so, the prophetic medicine is going to make you efficient, you know, and no need of anything else, you know, because I hear from already to some share or the writing of some share, they said whenever you have full confidence in the prophetic medicine, it's going to have the cure. And by this, you are no need of the modern medicine at all. If you are a physician, you just use it to treat the others.
Are there regular habits we should include in our schedules? Can you please advise us?
Everyone has his own experience. My experience started with those azkar in the morning and in the evening. Okay? Start with these azkar, either from Kitab al-Imam Nawawi al-Azkar or from At-Tarhib al-Tarhib al-Hafiz al-Munziri. Start to practicing the azkar after prayer, the azkar in the morning, the azkar in the evening. And by this, you are going to observe yourself, get used to this, aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time, and have certain connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Start like this. Besides the recite of Quran.
If one is reluctant to take bay'ah as they feel the age of taslim, submission, is over, as Ahmad Zahra said many centuries ago, how can we reliably identify our flaws?
Our flaws, deficiencies. They said that the Lord, or when we make salawat of the Prophet, this may take care of you and make you of no need of this. Even though they said you may still need a shaykh. So, besides this, you know, start salawat ala Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Let's start advising each other, you know, sincere advice and sincere acceptance from the other side. And have some night prayer asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you
Shaykhi, many scholars dedicate very much time to their family and expect the wife to deal with it. How do we achieve a balance, or should we just look for a very good wife?
I'm sorry, I missed the first question because I'm not Shaykh, and I was saying I'm not Shaykh.
Many scholars dedicate very little time to their family and expect the wife to deal with it. How do we achieve a balance, or should we just look for a very good wife?
be honest with you, I have this problem, you know, and I'm very bad husband, very bad housekeeper, house, yani, care, and whatever you want to describe in this regard, you know. I think this is an efficiency, and we should try to tolerate each other, you know, when we have the our spouse, you know, get involved in any matter, you know. I'm here, alhamdulillah, we are all healthy. If one of them is sick, what we are going to do as the other spouse? We are going to take care of everything, you know. If someone is busy, if somebody, one who is hard worker, you know, and earn money, you know, a lot, and doesn't come to home except, you know, a few hours, you know, at night, what we are going to be too happy when you lose such a person, you know. You don't tell him to come down, and you are going to take good care of the other. So let's have the same attitude when we have someone busy, you know, in teaching or busy in some Islamic religious matter.
Can a woman travel to be annoyed without a mahram?
For Fardul Ayn, no. For Fardul Ayn, yes. For the other thing, no. I think nowadays, even Fardul Ayn is available, you don't have to worry. So the answer in general is going to be no, it's too late.
What would you advise for a woman leaving her daughters with father or uncle? I have this question because many instances have taken place where a daughter is abused by father or uncle.
Yes. I have heard this story, even back in Syria it may happen, you know. It's our problem, you know, because we have this opening, you know, of stimulation all over the place, wherever we go. And we start to hear those matters. Faqah-wise, they said, when you have fasiq, that's mean, yani, you cannot trust such a person, you cannot leave your daughter alone with them, okay? Even if they are mahram, you know, even if they are brother or father or whatever. I think all of you, some of you maybe get really surprised about what I'm speaking about, but all of you should be aware of this point, you know, and don't take it easy, okay? And don't just be, yani, trust this person and that person. No, I put the mistrust as at first, and then out of your experience, if you find otherwise, then trust, okay? I'm sorry to say it in this way, because I have heard about many incidents, you know, back in Syria, and I imagine UK and elsewhere you have the same experience.